form.
Sorry, I'm just interrupting. We are recording this session. So just want everyone to
sure. So what I'm saying is that monuments never occur in individual form. There is a lot of focus, even from the official establishment, on individual monuments. You have, of course, the Taj Mahal, you have the Red Fort. Nobody or very few people focus on large zones. Heritage always occurs in large zones. Large zones, small zones, intermediate sized zones, they never focus on the larger picture. And those zones evolve over time. They don't stay constant. Different people come in, different empires come in, different religious figures come in. There are different cultural influences. So the zones change character. And kai baar un zones ke upar ek parat chad jati hai, jisse unki aaj ki tarikh mein pehchan ban jati hai. Shayad wo pehchan galat hai. To aaj ke talk mein main focus karna chahunga ek aise region pe jiski pehchan hum karte hain dakuon se. Lekin uski pehchan bahut gehri hai, and it goes well beyond the dacoits or bandits that may have once given it a certain degree of notoriety. So I would like to focus on one zone which goes beyond, the moment you go beyond Agra, you cross Dholpur, you cross the Chambal, and you enter into a sort of grey zone where people tend to whiz through while on their journey either to Gwalior or beyond to Khajuraho. So as it stands, I'll use various means. I'll use pictures, my own pictures, I'll use perhaps a few caricatures, I'll use a few coins, and I will use maps extensively. One other thing I would like to say before I begin is that I don't see history in being an isolation. When I study history, I study it in relation to maps. I study it in relation to maps of different types. Maps which give me the understanding of the area and maps which give me an understanding of the topography of the area. Because ek jagah itni important historically kyun bani, shayad uske reasons historical se zyada geographic hai. So I will use a lot of maps to bring the study alive. I will also use things from popular culture to show where and how a place's culture has developed over time. So now I'll share my screen and then we'll go further. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so I'll roll on here from now. So we're talking about the region south of the Chambal. There are four or five districts we'll talk about. The connotations more are to do with people like this that you see on your screen. Dacoits, Jagjeevan Parihar, Nirbhay Gujar, Pan Singh Tomar, who's perhaps the best known because of the movie. And Malkhan Singh, who surrendered and went into politics. The other three were killed by the police at various points in time. Malkhan Singh was smarter. But then this region is known because of a bunch of people like this and others, but it has a lot more. When I'm talking about the region, I'm plunging into these five districts to begin with. We'll begin and spend most of our time in Morena. We will also go and plunge into Bhind, into Datia, into Shivpuri, and we'll be based out of Gwalior, which is right in the middle of them. So it is from Gwalior that we'll have to position ourselves and take a view beyond. So here we are. That's where, to those who are not familiar with the map, that's where Gwalior is. As you go south of Agra, you cross Morena, you drive right through Morena town to reach Gwalior. So imagine you're in Gwalior now. So for the next possibly 45 minutes, you'll be on a journey through this zone. And we're going to begin from back in time. We're going to begin from prehistoric era, from about 15,000 years ago, and come forward in time, which will also show you the point I was trying to make, where how cultural changes happen in a single area. So my first foray into this place, I'm going to a place called Pahadgarh. So I'm driving north of Gwalior. I'm driving through Morena town, taking a left in Morena and going off the highway while driving left. So I drive past a place called Jorra. There are some interesting ways of pronouncing these words, so which I've learned going around. So if you pronounce it Jorra, people will not know what you're asking for. The pronunciation of this place is Jorra. You kind of stay a little longer on the R. You go to Kailaras and you take a left from there into Pahadgarh. A little bit of personal journey here. So when I went to this place, I went there for the first time in February 2012. And I realized I had made a big blunder. I reached this place. This is Pahadgarh Fort. This is a relatively recent fort. It's about a 17th, 18th century fort. It's still lived in by the royal family of that place. And the royal family of that place has a very rich history of its own. Their ancestors fought alongside Rana Sanga in the Battle of Khanwa against Babur in 1527. So if you ever go there, they will narrate their family history to you. But I was not hunting for this fort. This was not the objective of the journey. The objective of the journey was perhaps a lot more magnificent. And as I had shared in this slide earlier, it was 15,000 years old. So this is clearly not the objective. So when I reached here, the royal family said that I had made several mistakes while arriving here. A, I had arrived at 4 p.m. in the afternoon. That was mistake number one. Why was that a mistake? Because the place I had to see was about an hour away. And an hour away in January and February would have meant it would have become dark or very close to being dark. B, they had said the area is not safe. Remember the people's pictures who had shown you the dacoits? Some of them were still alive then. So the area was not safe. And they said, you need a police escort for which we'll need to make advanced preparation. That was number two. Number three, they said, you will need a person to take you there and show you the exact spot. Otherwise, you'll be looking for a needle in a haystack. Problem number four, the vehicle I was traveling in was a sedan. You need a vehicle with high ground clearance to go there. So all those four reasons combined to ensure that I did not complete the trip in 2012. I went back there this year. So the place I was headed to was not actually Pahadgarh, but it was a place about 14 kilometers away from Pahadgarh. A place where there is no mobile signal. There's no, I mean, I can't put it on GPS when I'm there. So it's about 13, 14 kilometers away, marked by this X. Where am I headed to? I'll show you a bit of what the route looks like. That's, you begin from Pahadgarh. The route is, well, it's a tarred road, though broken in patches. But then the tarred road goes away and you find organic obstacles on the road like this. And the road becomes steadily worse. And then you have to go off the road. As you can see there, the vehicle I came in January this year was had much better ground clearance. And you can see why it was needed. Look at the terrain. We're actually driving into a forest. We are driving over rocky terrain. But the vehicle can't go much. And this is the gentleman who actually was my spot finder. So when I travel on these journeys, I do a lot of talking to local people. Otherwise, I will never know what I'm seeing or where to look. So this gentleman is an Adivasi, a forest dweller called Sridhar. He lives there and he knows the forests and the region like the back of his hand. So I took him along. That's where we had to abandon the vehicle. So as you can see, the terrain gets worse. We are actually entering a river valley. So you are actually going down what is a dry waterfall. So this place becomes largely impassable in the current season, in the monsoon. So you have to go where it is drier. So we abandoned the vehicle here and began walking down this. So that's where the dry waterfall comes. So as you can see, there's a policeman on the screen. So there was an armed escort for this place, though I really feel it was not required. The area, however, you know, while all the dacoits have largely been killed, the area somehow retains an air of violence or the threat of the possibility of violence, because of which the police tend to keep an eye on people coming in and who are they meeting, etc. And that's where we are entering. Look at this landscape. Looks like a very surreal kind of landscape, right? That's the valley of the Assam River. The Assam River flows into the Chambal eventually. And that's what it looks like. It's a seasonal river, as you can guess from this one. This is January this year. The place I am taking this photograph one in is what is of interest. I'm in a rock shelter. And I'll play a video now, which kind of brings out why I came to this place and why I took the pain of going back here over a gap of 9 years. Can you see the video playing? It'll just start off. I was looking for this. I hope everybody can see the video moving.
This is similar to the Bhim Betika thing, na?
Yes, but it is.
Audio, we are not able to hear the audio.
No, there's no audio, so I'm going to just keep talking. So, there is no audio to this. This is, well, perhaps not as old as Bhim Betika. This is, the earliest ones have been dated to be 15,000 years old. The interesting part about rock art is that, if you say a rock art site is 15,000 years old, it is not a constant dating. Because a rock art site would have had rock art added to over thousands of years. So, the colors used here, the patterns used here, the symbolism within those patterns all gives us a hint. The fact that this site comes from prehistoric times and draws the narrative into historic times. So it's a huge narrative, which I will explain to you in the following slides. But imagine how rich the site is. And this is one site. This is the largest site at a place called Pahadgarh. There are at least a dozen more sites, many of which have perhaps lost in the forest. You just look over this, look at the figures, the variety and range of the figures carved here. So imagine early man, a hunter-gatherer, takes shelter here on a night when it is, on a day or a night when it is raining hard. And remember, the rain then thousands of years ago would have been far more intense and far more prolonged than it is now. Today, we have an apology for a monsoon season. So imagine him taking shelter here, perhaps for days on end. And in the time that he has here, he mixes red ochre with animal fat and uses twigs to draw this. We'll go beyond the video now to this. So the paintings are made largely of red ochre. So this clearly shows, the picture on the right shows hunter-gatherers, people on the move. Perhaps they were using twigs to draw this. The person on the left is clearly trying to kill somebody. So there's a bow and arrow. So the human traits are all visible here, and they go on to a different level. Look at this. Somehow, the human being then has learned to ride animals. He's riding elephants here, which it clearly shows the fact that man has made a significant degree of progress. There are metal weapons that have been found in the area which date back to 1500 BCE. And some of the paintings are perhaps as recent as 600 BC, which is just a few centuries before the Gupta era. Imagine this site, and let's go on. This picture was absolutely eyeball popping. As you can see, it's a picture of what looks like a bullock cart. So therefore, he's invented the wheel. So in one site, in remote Pahadgarh, you've got the journey of man being captured from being a hunter-gatherer to learning how to use animals, to leveraging them and entirely domesticating them, and to having a wheel being there. So it's actually a little microcosm of man's progress over centuries. But I wasn't the person who discovered this. The paintings came to light in the 1950s. The paintings perhaps were always known to the tribal community residing here. And they had their own stories. Story number one was that there were some ghosts or some superstitious figures attached to this. And that's how they managed to keep people away. Story number two, which is a real story, is that dacoits used to use these overhangs to hide themselves or to take shelter. And their presence meant that a lot of people got warded off. But the first formal documentation came by this person you see on the screen. Professor D.P.S. Dwarikesh was a professor of linguistics at the Western Michigan University. He was a native of Agra, and he had come back on a sabbatical to India when a friend of his, Sriram Sharma, who was a native of Pahadgarh, told him about these. The two friends came here on camelback. The journey I accomplished on a high road clearance SUV was done by camelback in 1979. And Dwarikesh spent many months documenting and taking thousands of photographs of the various rock art on these sites. And to him goes the credit of actually discovering it. Unfortunately, when he showed the findings to the ASI, they discarded it. They in fact threatened to file an FIR against him for touching the site. Quite disillusioned, the Dwarikesh left, and the site remains undocumented, unlisted, and unprotected even today, which is a real tragedy for this site. More recently, in the 1990s, it was further examined by historian Erwin Neumayer. And I have been in touch with him recently about this site, and he made a remarkable comment. He said that rock art is best when left neglected, and it is at its perhaps worst when it is discovered, because it tends to get destroyed. But what is happening clearly at this site now is you can see some scribbling, some graffiti by recent hands as well, which shows the need for it to get protected. One more thing before I go on from Pahadgarh is the figures that you can see on your screen. According to DPS Dwarikesh, remember, he was a linguist. He described these as ideographs, perhaps the first form of man learning to put down his thoughts in an organized manner in some form of writing or drawing in this case. It's a remarkable achievement and shows the level of human brain's progress over a period of time. It's a site worth going and seeing, and there are many more such. Recently, we've been hearing reports of a similar site being discovered in Mangarbani village in Faridabad. Perhaps that is similar. More exploration is needed. Let's go on. Let's take a big leap forward to the 3rd century BC, to something which is Mauryan. Where are we headed to? We headed south of Gwalior now into Dathia district, to a little place called Gujara. Gujara is as small a village as you can imagine. It's less than the average village size. It has about a population of a few hundred. But within that is this what looks like a stone shed. And within the stone shed, you find an inscription of Ashoka. Now, the minor and the major rock edicts of Ashoka have a little variation. The minor rock edicts are said to be those which came from the early part of his reign. His reign also, there is a little bit of doubt on exactly what year it began on. Was it 268 BC? Was it 272 BC? There's a little bit of doubt there, but let's stick to that broad range. And this is a rare rock edict, one of, I think, two or three only, which mentions him by name. What I've given at the bottom is the fading version of the carving on that rock, and which says Piyadasi Ashoka Raja. That's an interesting way of, that's one of the two or three very rare places where you have Ashoka mentioned by name. And what you have today is a little village completely unknown south of Gwalior, where you can go and find it. Let's go further. Let's take another leap. The Hunas appeared next in this region, 4th to 6th century, and they didn't leave too much, at least not much that we can see. They did, however, build a sun temple, and there's an inscription found here in Gwalior which mentions Thoraman. Now, Thoraman was a very fierce Huna ruler. If you look at the history of the Hunas, you'll find they were very fierce warriors, and perhaps some of the Rajputs of today descended from them. So he ruled at the end and towards the beginning of the 5th, 6th century. And the inscription mentions Thoraman as building a sun temple in or around Gwalior. There is no sign of any sun temple anymore out there, but there is still a mention, which is why we mentioned him into context here. we go on to two dynasties on which we will spend most of our time, the Gujar Pratiharas, who were the overlords for 300 plus years in this region, and their vassals, the Kachpagatas. Initially, their vassals, in fact, their vassals for almost three centuries before the Gujar Pratiharas weakened and the Kachpagatas found their own independence for at least a certain period of time. And their influence is very wide. So that's a broad map of the Gujar Pratihara dynasty. And within them, the Kachpagatas not shown here were largely occupying the area around Gwalior. Once the Gujar Pratiharas began to weaken, the Kachpagatas were able to get their own independence. And so were the Chandelas, who built initially Khajuraho and many other places, Khajuraho, Kalinjar, Mahoba, to the east. We will not go towards the east. We will stick to this region. Let's go a little further. Our first port of call is a little place called Narwar. Narwar is now completely going off the map. You're going south of Gwalior on what is called the AB Road, the Agra-Bombay Road. And we're looking at taking a little detour towards the east to Narwar. Why is Narwar so important? And why are we talking of Narwar? The reasons, as I had mentioned at the beginning of my talk, are not historic but geographic. Any army penetrating south of Gwalior or Delhi or Agra will have to go through this region. Now, you might say that why can't they go here? Why can't they go here? Look at the topography of the area. Look at how green it still looks. And imagine then it would have been much more green and thickly forested there. But the biggest problem are how to ford rivers. Are you able to see this orange arrow on the left of Narwar? The orange arrow indicates the river Chambal, which is currently the border between Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. So the state border is the river Chambal. The yellow arrow is the river Sindh, and it flows right next to Narwar Fort. The black arrow is the river Betwa. So any army or anybody else marching southwards to the Deccan or vice versa will have to find a way which prevents minimum damage to the army when they're crossing a river. So they will try and find a way where they can minimize. So they will cross the river at the Chambal here. They will ford the Chambal beyond Dholpur. They will touch Gwalior and they will move southwards. Therefore, on that road, occupation of Narwar becomes critical. So you go on from Narwar, you go further. And this is, of course, the modern highway. The older highway would have swung differently. You have Mandu right here, where my cursor currently is. You go a little here, you have Burhanpur. North of Burhanpur, you have a fortress called Asirgarh. So these essentially are the gateways to the Deccan. Let's go into Narwar now. That's what Narwar looks like today. It's a fort which you have to climb up. The vehicle doesn't go up. It's one of the biggest forts of central India. For those who have seen Gwalior Fort, you may want to know that Narwar occupies a slightly bigger area. Unfortunately, it's completely abandoned to the elements. It was a part of the Gupta and the Harshvardhana kingdoms as well. It was seized by the Kachpagatas after they broke free of the overlordship of the Gujar Pratiharas. And from them, it passed to the Delhi Sultanate rulers, to the Tomars, and then back to the Kachpagatas who returned to the region, eventually going over to the Mughals, won by the Sindhya. So everybody who's been somebody in North and Central India has occupied Narwar at some point of time. And Tatya Tope is believed to have been hanged here in 1859. What's the fort currently like? This is the state of affairs. See, there's nothing of the ancient era left in this fort. All that you see is medieval. The building on the left is the Kacheri. The building on the right is a chapel for the German gunners of the Sindhya army stationed here. So you've got different cultures intermingling in one place. Let's go further. Recognize this screenshot from any movie? Does anybody recognize this?
Pan Singh Tomar.
Bang on. That's Pan Singh Tomar, and that's the character on the left, shot largely inside Narwar Fort. And you know, when I went to Narwar, I found an interesting phenomenon there. It's the only place where I had a brush with dacoits myself. Thankfully, they were looking quite harmless, possibly inside, I was inside their home. There are a few old temples heavily restored inside Narwar, and the pujaris here act as bankers for the dacoits. So when I came there were a few dacoits there, and that's one of the dacoits you can see on your screen. I didn't want to photograph him in front of him, just lest he take a little offense. So I decided to take a photograph after his back was turned to me. So, and these guys had come here to deposit their money or withdraw it as they feel fit. So the temples and the pujaris effectively act as their banks and bankers. It's an interesting phenomenon. Perhaps it's a phenomenon that's been alive for years. That was my only in-person brush with dacoits in the region. A little more about Narwar. So this is taken from a classic Sanskrit epic, which is an offshoot of the Mahabharata. It's a story of Nal Damayanti. Now, Nalapuram, which is the city where Nal came from, is identified as Narwar. And by the 8th century, which is the time when the Gujar Pratiharas really began to really take control of the region and became big, Narwar was a cultural hub. amongst the scholars who came here was a gentleman called Bhavabhuti, perhaps one of the foremost Sanskrit poets, second only to Kalidas. And amongst the best known plays he wrote is something called Malati Madhavan, where there is a city called Padmavati. And that is identified again with Narvar. So Narvar, an abandoned fortress today, which perhaps you haven't even heard of, was the setting of some extraordinary medieval plays or perhaps even ancient plays. Let's put it further. So I'm sure those who've been to Rajasthan, my state, have come across this painting in various forms. A man and a woman on horseback. So on cloth, on ceramic, on stone. So I don't know if you know the name of this. It's the story of Dhola Maru. It's basically a ballad. Dhola, or to give him his proper name, Dulha Rai, was a Kachpagata prince of Narvar who went looking for the bride he had married as a child and had then forgotten somehow. So some bards arrived at Narvar. They sang the story of the child marriage and the forgotten bride. And Dhola or Dulha Rai remembered the princess he had forgotten, and he went back to get her in an epic journey across a desert. So where would he have gone if he crossed a desert? He would have crossed with the western desert somewhere. Maru was supposed to be the princess of a kingdom called Pugal. We don't know where exactly Pugal is. Perhaps it is in the Marwad region of Rajasthan. Perhaps it is in what is now Pakistan's Sindh. But then the ballad lives on in its various forms. And when Dulha Rai returned to Narvar, the person he had left his kingdom in charge of had taken over the kingdom. So he had no kingdom to go. Dulha Rai went back westward. His son went on to found the kingdom called Amer, which we now know as Jaipur. So there are links between Narvar's Kachpagatas and Jaipur's Kachwaha dynasty, which are direct and withstand the test of time even today. Let's go a little further to more medieval times. An interesting painting. This painting is drawn from the Akbarnama. Perhaps the best known copy of the Akbarnama has come to us. It was written by Abul Fazal, of course. It's come to us through a very circuitous route. The inscriptions on this painting, based on the translations I have read, show that the painting was done by an article called Basavan, supported by an artist called Tara Bade, also written as Tara the Elder, if you translate that. And this copy was acquired by an East India Company Major General who served as the Commissioner of Awadh. He later went back and then he died. His widow sold it to the Victoria and Albert Museum, where it currently lies. What does this painting indicate and why have I used it here? That's a closer shot. Now the painting indicates, as its inscription says, that Akbar is killing a tiger at Narvar. And the painting says that Akbar and his entourage, when on a hunt, disturbed a tigress with her cubs. And Akbar killed it in a single blow. That, of course, may be exaggeration, but that's what the inscription says. So here is an example of how Narvar lives on, even in the medieval era, as a relevant place. So where would Akbar have stayed when he was on a hunt in Narvar? Probably inside the fort. Let's go on. Close to Narvar, a little south of it, where we take the plunge into the Kachpagata temples for the first time and which we will spend some time on, is a place called Surwaya. Now, just feast your eyes on Kachpagata architecture. Now, there is a lot of back and forth as to whether this temple was built by the Gujjar Pratiharas or the Kachpagatas. To me, there is no difference because the Kachpagatas were vassals of the Gujjar Pratiharas. So if you were to say that these Shiva temples were built under the overlordship of the Gujjar Pratiharas, you would not be technically incorrect. The inscriptions here mention a Kachpagata ruler of the area of a date corresponding to the 10th century. There are three temples here. All of them are Shiva temples. There is also a small step well inside which there is a carving of an Anantasai Vishnu. It's a beautiful step well. It's got some turtles, etc. inside. Around the entire complex is a medieval 16th, 17th century fort wall. It's interesting. So somebody added a protective layer to this temple in the medieval era. It's interesting that a medieval ruler also felt the need to protect the heritage of that era. Otherwise, it would have been destroyed by now. And in the following slides, we will see various examples of how temples have been laid waste to in the area. But let's spend one more slide just feasting our eyes on Surwaya. Surwaya lies directly on the highway that connects Shivpuri to Jhansi. Just feast your eyes on a lot of the iconography here. Let's go further. Now we'll go back to Gwalior and start driving north of Gwalior. We will go to a little place called Naresar. Here I will take off the PPT and show you a little video. Just give me a sec. Vikram, can you confirm? Can you see this video now?
Right now we can't.
Are you able to see Hidden Heritage as the black frame?
No. Right now I can see your PPT.
Okay,
let me again stop sharing.
I will have to stop sharing and share again. Just give me a sec. Yeah, let's just go through. This will take a minute to go through.
So you have to switch on the audio also within that.
Okay, I'll just talk about it. So I wanted to kind of just see this visually as to how remote, let's just go back a few frames. I wanted to see how remote this place is. Naresar is north of Gwalior. And look at this. This is the last approach road. And Vikramjit has also visited this. Yeah. Not too far from the Gwalior Air Force Base. So this time I went from the back of it. I walked through a little forest here. And this is the back entrance. What would have been the original ceremonial entrance to a large temple complex. So we enter the place. That's what it looks like. So you've got vegetation on one side. It's completely out in the forest. So the first time I went from the left of your frame. The second time I went from the right of your frame. So there are two very different ways. On the left are hills. On the right is a forested region. So this is typically a yogini site. Vidya Dahejia, in her book on yoginis, a seminal work done by the National Museum, has written extensively about this site. So as you can see, there are about 23 temples here, and including some that are below the ground. So this is an amateur video I shot and kind of pieced together. So yoginis typically have been, you know, at the periphery of the Hindu faith, an offshoot of the Hindu faith, which has also been a little terrifying for local people. So you will find yogini sites in extremely remote areas, in areas where there is no or barely any human habitation. Even today, you will find there are hardly any villages around. And this is a classic yogini shrine with one difference, which we'll elaborate on.
Was this also a later inspiration for tantric faith and everything?
It would have been entirely a tantric site. So yogini sites were deeply associated with tantric worship. The remarkable thing is, as you can see in this temple, is that the site remains in worship by the local villagers. It's ASI protected in terms of having an ASI board, but it remains in worship. So 1,000 years or perhaps 1,200 years after it was built, the faith is still there. It's remarkable. And you can see how remote the site is. There is, as you sometimes say, na insan ki zaat.
No, but Arjun, I think ye beech mein abandon ho gaya hoga aur fir dobara se logo ne aake yahan pe worship start ki, because the Hanuman statue that we see here, because KK Mohammed Sahib has confirmed that Nirbhay Singh Gujar installed the Hanuman statue at Bateshwar. So, yahan par Babu Ram Gadariya jo bhi group tha, unhone apna kiya hoga, wo daka dalne se pehle jaate the worship karne ke liye. Now, since they have been eliminated, then probably the worship has restarted.
So, I actually...
You're right, Vikramjit. You know, all throughout the country, there are these very abundant sites which have later on become living sites, which were abundant at a particular point of time, and with the increase in population and habitation, that and for people to hide out. So yeah, those became, you know, the first, it's all over Delhi as well.
So the first time I went there was when some of the dacoits were still alive. So yeah, and so even then this was in worship. What is now happening is that the site is under slight threat. What is happening now is that there is some rock mining, etc. happening around, which is of extremely high concern to this site. So as we go in, you will realize that the site, which would have had perhaps a shivaling inside, has a makeshift idol within, which is of very recent origin. Somebody just installed something there, and I couldn't make out what this was. So they're worshipping inside that. So in a way, faith lives on.
Perhaps so the red thing there, the Oni, shows that it is of some female fertility cult.
Yeah.
So some version of Parvati.
Some version of Parvati, and therefore continuing the yogini tradition in a way.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's what a few more quick pictures of the site. That Hanumanji, as you can see, is of very recent origins, would have probably been installed by the dacoits who took shelter here. And we'll share one last picture of the idol, which is a little underground. It's a Shivalinga, which is below the surface. We'll just come to that. We're going into this one, going a little level below, and that's where it ends. So imagine this Shivalinga and how it was accessed. It looks like a house of cards right now if an earthquake were to come, but I hope it survives. I'll just go back to my PPT. Just a sec.
This brings back so many memories. Early morning, 5 o'clock, I started my trek to this place when I went there last.
Yeah.
Amazing sight.
So that's where we've covered Naresar. Let's go on to Aethi. So these are now small villages around. So these are villages which Vikramji, I was saying that, you know, the entire thing is a zone. So yeah. when I went there for the first time in 2005-06, I also went to Mitauli, Padhauli, Bateshwar first, and then to Kakanmat. And in subsequent trips, I began to look at, talk to local villagers, probe in areas where perhaps nobody has probed before. And this is one of the finds. So this is a little village called Aethi in Morena, very, very close to the other sites that we are more familiar with. Again, a Kutch Pagoda temple, a Vishnu temple at that. And let's take a closer look. We go into the sanctum sanctorum of this. Take a closer look. So the Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh have been defaced. But my attention was caught by this panel on top. So let's take a closer look at the panel. It's a Saptamatrika panel. Now, a classic Saptamatrika panel can be recognized either by way of the Vahanas of the goddesses or by the weapons. Now, in this case, they have been defaced and the weapons have been broken off and there are no Vahanas. Now, in some cases, there is a swan. Some cases, there is something else. Some cases, there is an elephant. So, typically, an Indrani would be on an elephant. A Maheshwari would be on a Nandi equivalent. A Brahmani would be on a swan. Now, in this case, there are no Vahanas and the weapons are broken off. So, I could only identify for sure Varahi by way of the face, Chamunda by way of the skull and bone figure. This is Ganesha. This is possibly Veerbhadra. The others would probably be Brahmani, Vaishnavi, Maheshwari, Indrani, and Kaumari. So I want to park this that again in an absolutely ordinary, dusty village in Morena, you have such antiquity still alive. Let's go further into this village.
Arjun, just one question.
Yep.
This is a region which was not very largely Islamic in the later years. I mean, you had Islamic rule, of course, in an overarching way. But the local suzerainty was there with the Rajas,
yes.
If I'm not wrong.
You're absolutely right. The difference was that this region, even its geographical position, lay directly on the road to the Deccan and from the Deccan. So a lot of armies would have marched through it.
And you think that... this kind of defacing which has happened, I mean, in remote locations, like in Rankiba or in other places in Gujarat that I've seen, also in Rajasthan and Central India, defacing has been much lesser than in the main urban and, So, how do you think this happened? Because the rest of the bodies are fine.
Oh, yes, it's quite strange. So, I think perhaps somebody just chipped away at those faces. It is perhaps, let me just go back, look at this. It is primarily the faces that have been destroyed.
Yes, yes.
So, you
that doesn't stand. Yeah.
To deface an idol, you knock it off. What is the easiest part of the body to chop off? The limbs,
the face.
The extremities, yeah. Right? So, the hands in this case would have been more difficult to chop off because they're part of the idol's overall structure.
Yeah.
So, what sticks out is the face. So, you can actually put a sword or an axe next to it and chip it away.
Got it. And then sent abroad. I mean, this would have been like, when has the defacing happened is important for us to see because there's a lot of culture theft that happened in the last 200 years.
Absolutely. In fact, some of the sites I visited in, for example, in Bihar, we've got pictures by Joseph Beglar, Cunningham's photographer, which show them as largely intact in the 1860s and 1870s. And now they're damaged. Yeah. So obviously the damage is not Islamic. The damage is more recent.
Yeah, and must be there in a museum abroad.
Some of the idols I've seen are still here. For example, there's a place called Gadwa, south of Allahabad, where there's an 1870 photograph taken by Joseph Beglar, which shows the idol in a near perfect state. And today the idol is chipped away. Almost half of it is gone. So obviously between 1870 and when I saw it, something has happened, probably between that and independence. And remember, the isolation of this particular area in Morena and around means that there is a ripe territory for antique smugglers.
Yeah.
So let's go here. Aethi also has more temples. This apparently is a sun temple built by the Kutch Pagodas. And how do I know it's a sun temple built by them? Because there was an inscription found here, an inscription that was moved to the museum in Gwalior. But what is interesting here is that it has seen later work. So this, the pattern on the roof is clearly later work. A lot of it has been restored by the Gwalior princely state in their forays into the area in 1920s, 1930s. So to them goes the credit of doing some restoration, though perhaps a lot of mistakes are also made then, some of the examples of which we will see in the slides to come. What is most heartbreaking about Aethi is a shrine that I found on its outer parts, a completely broken shrine with only its plinth or its base left intact. So all around the base are these little idols inside their niches. Possibly a Kutch Pagoda temple, possibly slightly later as well. It's completely broken, and this by far outsizes the two Vishnu and the Surya temples that I've shown you earlier. Some of the idols were lying here in the vegetation, etc. I just hope somebody preserves it. I've given a report to the officials who could take action. Let's hope they have done so. We next move to
Arjun. Yeah. Is this what you just showing? Is this the Aiti village, or it's near Pauni where we have that Shani temple?
No, this is actually, they are all very close to each other. So the Shanichara temple is close to a village called Paroli. So this one is just 3 kilometers away.
Right. So this is a proper Aiti village. Because proper, वहाँ पर भी पावनी ruins हैं. Shanichara temple के पास भी पावनी ruins हैं. वो भी ऐसे ही हैं.
बिल्कुल. So आप वो जो ये हल्का सा आपको दिख रहा है जहाँ मेरा mouse cursor है.
हाँ, yes.
That is Aiti village. That's a new temple in Aiti village, and I'm just outside the village now.
Okay, got it.
So I am on the outskirts of this village, on the road that will eventually take me to Padavali, etc.
Okay.
Before I reach Padavali, I've reached a place called Barahavali. So, इसको आप map पे आज ढूंढोगे तो आपको ये Barahavali की spelling से मिलेगा. Its original spelling would have been Varahavali, named after a Varaha temple here, and that's the temple. Once more, you see a pattern which shows a later period of restoration, possibly by the Gwalior state. Unfortunately, the idol of this temple, the Varaha idol, which would have given not just the temple but the village its name, has been stolen long back. It was stolen in the 1990s. So when I walked through the village, a few villagers came and they kind of asked me to have tea with them. But after confirming my final name, so there is a little bit of a caste factor which plays. So
yeah.
They were Tomars, and after they had asked me for village, after they asked me for coming to the village for tea, they suddenly realized ki yaar ye banda hai kaun. So then they wanted to know my full name. So once they knew my full name, they said, okay, chalo, the caste factor is strict. We can have tea with this guy.
Arjun, how far is this from Mithavali?
About half an hour. That's all. And we are headed to Mithavali after this.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So there are numerous Shivalingas also on the outskirts of Barahavali village, which I saw. Not sharing it here because it will become too lengthy a presentation and kind of conversation. So we are now close to Mithavali. We will go back to Bateshwar slightly later. So what you see in a place called Padavali is actually a medieval fort built by the Jat rulers of Dholpur in the 18th century. That's highly misleading. And like in the case of Surwaya, it was built to preserve a beautiful Shiva temple inside. Now, a lot of people would call this Gujar Pratihara. Technically, they'll be right. The Kachpakatas were their vassals. These photographs taken over a period of 10 different years. Just feast your eyes inside. So when I said that the Gwalior state had made a few mistakes in the preservation, that part within is a little bit of a bleached effect, perhaps usage of chemicals gone wrong in removing soot. So you can see a lot of black marks on these idols, which is a little bit of soot there. So perhaps in the 1920s, when the Gwalior state began working on this, they tried to use a chemical to remove the soot, and it kind of bleached the Chamunda idol in the middle. So every bit of the ceiling is carved. That looks like a Vishnu. And we have a Uma Maheshwar here. So the entire pantheon of the Hindu religion is perhaps showcased here on the ceiling of a tiny temple. And we'll just go after this. It's a feast to the eyes.
Can you repeat?
Sorry, you had a question.
What is this temple name? Can you please repeat?
It's a Shiva temple at a place called Padavali.
Now, if you want to search, you'll have to find it as Gadi Padavali. That's how it is famous now.
Yeah. So we are here. We're standing at Padavali. And when you stand on top of the fort in Padavali, you can see a little hillock at the far end. That's Mithavali. So Pramit, what you'd asked for, we are on the same route. So let's go a little further.
Right.
That's what Mithavali looked like the first time I saw it. So the first time I went there in 2005, there was no road. It was a dirt track, and it was a dirt track which had huge craters in it. So we somehow managed to bump our way through it, and we found this place. Now it's become like a tourist attraction with a lot of people from Gwalior coming here for the weekend, etc. So sometimes I miss the days when it was a little more tranquil. It's got lots of names. It's called Ekateshwara Mahadev. It's called a Chausat Yogini Temple, which is what it was. It's called a Shiv Sansad. Sansad being an interesting suffix to that. It's again a 9th, 10th century Kachpagata temple. This is classic Yogini architecture.
Yogini. It's absolutely Yogini architecture.
Yeah. And unfortunately, there is not a single Yogini idol here in it anymore. At some point of time, probably not in the beginning, somebody placed Shiva shivalingas in all its niches, in all its little chambers that you see around it. So you've got these little chambers all around. So every single one of them has a shivling. And this is where I would love to talk about the great work done by the ASI. Take a look at this. A lot of people talk about this temple as being very similar in design and perhaps inspiring the design of the Indian Parliament. I haven't found conclusive evidence of it. The conclusive evidence can only come in the form of documents presented to Herbert Baker when he was designing the Parliament. A, that, or B, when they took a little trip around India, did they actually come here? So perhaps there is a secret still hidden inside National Archives somewhere. The visual similarities cannot be wished away. It's obviously there. It's one concentric circle inside another. Let's go inside. It's also Gothic in style. So there's a little bit of Gothic inspiration in our Parliament. Or perhaps was inspiration drawn from this building. We'll perhaps never know the answer, but the visual similarities cannot be wished away. Let's go further. Let's take an aerial view. It's definitely like a wheel. It's got a central chamber. And if you want to see some of the most perfect and intact yogini temples, you'll have to go to Orissa. You'll have to go to two places in Orissa. One is a place called Ranipur Jharial, which is in Bolangir district, best access from Chhattisgarh's Sirpur. The other place is just outside Bhuvaneshwar, a little village called Hirapur. So as you can see, the central dome of parliament at which combined sessions happen of both houses, perhaps drew a little bit of similarity, if not just from the Sanchi Stupa from which gives it its dome, but from the overall design of this temple.
The coincidence is too much to be wished away, actually.
Yeah, yeah, it's just too much.
Central structure in the Yogini temple suggests that there would have been a build-up. If it wasn't a dome, it would have been something over there on the terrace, which has possibly been chipped away.
But the other question is, if it was 8th, 9th century Kachpagata architecture, had they moved into giving the temple its upper form as yet? Or were they
no, the dome wouldn't have been there. Because
the dome wouldn't have been there.
It would have been too early.
Yeah,
but some structure would have been there.
Possibly. Let's go further. This is where, you know, you really commend the ASI. This is how I saw it the first time around in 2005. A part of the hill had eroded and gone away, taking with it about four of the chambers of this temple. What I saw in 2011 was completely what ASI had done was they had reconstructed the hill. They had used wire mesh and netting to bind rocks together and had reconstructed the temple on top of it. The work was so remarkable that you could make out a difference between the broken and reconstructed part and the new and the older original part. We'll go further from here.
You don't have the picture of the construction.
Oh, I have it, but I haven't shared it here. Okay. I'll be happy to kind of pass it on to the group later.
Sure.
So let's go further to a place called Bateshwar, the largest of the temple sites in this area. So we were here in Mithavali, we've done Padhavali. Amledha, which we will not cover, has also got a small shrine. Barahavali, we've already come past. So forget Hanuman temple. Hanuman temple is new. Barahavali has the older temple. We're going to Bateshwar next. So just feast your eyes on a vast temple site, which has what? Over 200 temples or so? Now, this is on the outer extremities of Bateshwar. This, to my mind, reminds me of another Yogini shrine. So Vikram, I don't know what your belief is. These small shrines built so close to each other, and all we have are these five shrines standing. Now imagine if they were going around in a certain formation. Was this another Yogini site which has been destroyed? If you've seen, for example, the Yogini temple site in Khajuraho, on the outskirts of Khajuraho, that's not a circular shrine. It is a shrine built like a square with a large courtyard in the middle. It could be that. I've asked KK Mohammed sir, but he also was not very sure. He said perhaps it could be. So these are the various Bateshwar shrines. So the first time I saw them, a lot of these were covered by grass and vegetation. This part wasn't visible at all. What you see, the Shivalinga in the foreground, etc., was completely covered by sand and vegetation. And it was painstakingly cleared away by the ASI over a decade. And all these temples revealed. So was this entire area, there is one inscription that says that the area was perhaps a vast site of learning, where rather than looking at it as many different sites, you actually look at it as a large temple zone where the temples are essentially built to commemorate a place of learning. That's another theory. There's one inscription which says that, but it is not corroborated by any other inscription. So there is a little bit of a theory which still does the rounds. Some people called it like a golden triangle university, which is, I think, really not factually correct. we shouldn't be limited to triangles, etc., just because three sites are well known. This temple, where I first went, was not visible at all. It's a huge temple, perhaps the largest temple in Bhateshwar. It's called the Bhuteshwar Nath Temple. As the name suggests, it's a Shiva temple and it gives the name to Bhateshwar. So from Bhuteshwar Nath comes Bhateshwar. And this temple was completely buried into the hill the first time I saw the site in 2005. No part of the temple was visible. So I've kind of seen archaeology bringing out these marvels in front of me. So since we've spoken of the marvels, let's go on a little more of the iconography of the Bhuteshwar Nath temple. Let's go on to talk about a little more of the iconography. So you've got here, what you have here, what you can see here, you see the Varaha avatar, you see the Narasimha avatar, you see the Vaman, you see what could be a Haldhar. Balram was also at one point in time one of the avatars. Or it could be the Buddha going by the matted hair. You've got a Parashuram looking at this. This looks like an axe. And so on till Kalki on a horse. So one of the Bhateshwar temples has a clearly intact version of the Dashavatar, beginning with the fish here. So again, a magnificent creation built over time. Now the Bhateshwar temples have had numerous inscriptions. They got a lot of inscriptions of the Gujar Pratiharas themselves. So I remember this very interesting interaction between the man who is responsible for bringing out Bhateshwar, Sri K.K. Mohammed, perhaps one of India's finest archaeologists. He braved dacoits and politicians. I don't know who is more dangerous these days, but he braved both of them in the restoration process. So when he went to this site in 2005, I was sort of wandering around in the area. He was there from 2004 onwards. And he went at a time when dacoits were alive, active and dangerous. And he came across Nirbhay Gujar. And he found this innocuous man, maybe somewhat dirty looking guy sitting at one site. And he told him to get out. That guy was smoking a bidi. So he told him to move out of the site. And
that was the best. Sorry? Bhuteshwar temple ke bahar hi mile the wo.
Huh. And he was smoking a bidi. So Mr. Mohammed told him to get out from here. Don't you have any respect for this place? So Mr. Mohammed's associates were telling him to kind of calm down, and this is a very dangerous dacoit and all that. But such was his passion for archaeology that he told a dacoit to get lost. Then he realized later that this is a notorious dacoit, and he very adroitly took the support of the dacoit and leveraged the dacoit's own sense of fear to help preserve the site. So he kind of told him, remember this guy's name was Nirbhay Singh Gujar, who built the site, the Gujar Pratihara. So he told him that you are a descendant of this magnificent dynasty that built the temples. So please learn to become the preserver of the temples. So as long as he was there, as long as Nirbhay Singh Gujar was alive, rock mining and rock blasting did not happen in the area. After he was killed in an encounter, once more rock mining and rock blasting happened, and it continues till today. So Mr. Mohammed wrote to various people. He went over the heads of his superiors, wrote to Shivraj Singh Chauhan. Shivraj Singh Chauhan was very angry with him. And then eventually he wrote to the head of one of the Hindutva organizations, which finally took note. The head of the RSS took note, and to some extent the blasting stopped. But then again things have changed. The blasting continues unabated in this area, though there is at least a good amount of security now to the sites themselves. There may be a million persons in the archaeological profession like him, because he's a real gem. We'll go on to Kakanmat. Another great celebration of must be done here of the ASI. Now, the first time I saw Kakanmat, it was not fully reconstructed. There were still some parts that were being pieced together. So how the ASI discovered this site when it was lying completely demolished with various parts lying all over the place. So it was like assembling a giant jigsaw. So they named it, they numbered all the parts, and they built it level by level back to what you see on your screen. It's 155 feet high, apparently, from base to top. And as inscriptions and ASI records have it, it was destroyed. It was an 11th century temple, perhaps the acme of Kachpagata architecture, as you can see by the tremendous Shikhara style that they've been able to achieve, and was destroyed in the 12th century by Iltutmish. So here we've moved to another dynasty. Here you see a period where the Sultanate period begins and the temple's architecture begins to get hit. And before we get to that period, let's talk about a conflict and what remains of that conflict in this area. The conflict is between two very powerful dynasties, the Chahamanas or the Chauhans of Delhi, led by Prithviraj, who met the army of Paramardi Dev, the Chandela king. The final battle between them, the decisive battle, was fought in a little village called Amaha. Amaha is as tiny as a village goes. It's completely out of the way and it is in Bhind district. So I'm driving through from Gwalior eastwards through Datia into Bhind, into this little village called Amaha. But about halfway on that journey, I run into a little, an even tinier place called Hastinapur. Nothing to do with the Mahabharata. Now imagine these are two very large armies. Let's give you a little bit of the historical context. The year is 1182. If you go back to your history, what happens in 1191? Prithviraj Chauhan is able to defeat Muhammad Ghori. What happens in 1192? Prithviraj Chauhan is defeated by Muhammad Ghori. The Sultanate period effectively begins. This battle is fought in 1182, a battle which is very large. You have one dynasty coming out of Mahoba and Kalinjar and moving westward with its large army. In that army are two celebrated warriors called Alha and Udal. You have another very large army of Prithviraj Chauhan moving southeastwards from Delhi and Ajmer, and they meet here. You know, when a large army marches through an area, what happens? It leaves remains of a military nature. So when I began probing into villages here, I found many things, one of which I'd like to share. That little thing protruding from the ground is called the Alha Udal ki Katar. Katar meaning dagger. So when I touched it, it looks like stone, but it feels like metal, probably some kind of alloy. What is the kind of thing jispe aap log chakku churi kitchen ke liye tez karte ho? On a similar thing, like, yeah, tez karte the till about a generation ago, till our mother's and grandmother's generation were there. This is not dissimilar. So was this the kind of thing on which blades were sharpened before going into battle? We don't know. Obviously, the whole thing is lying buried in the ground, inside a field. And perhaps there is room for excavation, which can lead us to what is the full extent of this structure. Is it actually something to do with the battle, or is it some part of another building which is lying here? So there are numerous remains in the area around which need to be seen.
How big is this Alha Udal ki Katar?
The part protruding from the ground is about, this is about 2 feet. It's about roughly 2 by 2. But it is absolutely immovable. So whatever is buried inside is much larger than what is showing on the surface.
Right.
So let's go a little further to the last temple of this talk. We'll go north of Gwalior. We are going back into Bhind. Now the temples I've talked about here, I've talked about a dozen or so temples. I could actually list down 2 dozen more and the talk can go on and on. I just tried to bring you some illustrated examples of this. So we'll go to a little place called Sita Ram Ki Lavan. That's what I saw there. It's a hardcore village. So the villagers got very interested in somebody coming to photograph something in their village, and they were all asking me what this is all about. So that's what I saw there. Let's take a look at these three interesting places, three interesting things. So you've got a temple in the middle. You've got broken idols all around. Broken idols like this. Look at perhaps the antiquity of these idols takes us back to the 10th, 11th century period, perhaps another Kachpagata temple. But this is unique in one feature. Look at this. It has got two levels. It's got a Pataleshwar inside it. So one feature which I had not seen anywhere else is found here. It's got two levels of where it can be worshipped, extensively carved here. So you go down and you go up. The upper part has the base of the linga with a lot of broken fragments of idols taken from perhaps this temple itself or perhaps other temples that existed in this village. And as you can see, there are cattle around, etc. It's a hardcore village. You've got nalis flowing freely. The lower part has got a shivalinga. And when I touched the linga, it seemed to be of a later period than the yoni itself. So there is obviously the people in the village have made an attempt to bring idols together, gather elements around, bring it together in one spot. And in the process, also found this thing. What is this? This is perhaps an intact version of the Saptamatrika that we saw earlier. So look at this. This is, you can actually make out a little more of this. You can see the Varahi. You can see a little more of, you can see the Ganesha. You can see another one. Perhaps this is a Veerbhadra on the side. So there is a huge temple that was existing here. And this clearly did not come from a temple of this size. This is too small for it. So this panel, which is almost like 7 feet in width, could only have come from some other temple which has entirely been destroyed in the region. Well, credit to the state archaeological department for at least listing this site and the villagers for bringing it together. So this is where I'll end my talk. So, you know, we've come a long distance. We've covered all the dynasties which are in pink here, but I could do another version of this talk for all the dynasties that came. For all the, for the Sultanate period people, for the Tomars who built the Gwalior Fort as we see it today, the various Bundelas who came into the region, the Mughals who came in and had a linkage with the Bundelas, the Jats and Marathas who came later, and lastly, the Europeans. But we'll stop here and we'll have a little conversation now, try and answer any queries that you may have. Yep.
This was actually awesome. Many of the sites even I didn't know. So thanks for sharing this. And over to the audience if you have any questions or comments.
Hi, Arjun. That was absolutely brilliant. So just tell me, like, who were the notable kings of Gujjar Pratiharis or Kachapagattas? Because then the Tomas came, the Chauhans and the Tomas, right?
Yeah. So there were numerous kings. So we will not go into each of them. Perhaps the biggest influence in the area was that of the Kachapagattas, which is what you can see in most of these temples. And you can see era after era, you can see the changing of architectural style, you can see the evolution of architectural style here. And we've gone further into so many periods.
So can you notice the change in architectural?
Yes, you see, for example, if you see some of the smaller shrines, if you move away from Bateshwar and Padavali, you go to places like Barahwali, you see very small shrines, you see very tiny shrines. And then you find the shrines have got a bigger shape, bigger form, they've got a little shikhara. They've got more detailed iconography inside as you go further. And then you find that around the period of the 9th, 10th century, you find it very unique, like bold experiments in shapes that start happening. You find the circular shape, which is a remarkable experiment in design for the Yogini temples. You take one further leap, you know, for somebody to build a shikhara on top of a temple, which is like 60 feet high, it's a feat of engineering. It would have taken a lot of belief by the pattern builder to sanction that. So it is remarkable that you've got people who are willing to fund the construction of these temples up to a certain point. So there is, from very small shrines in Barahwali and Eti to larger shrines in Padavali to larger shrines still and more carving still in Surwaya to bold experiments in Mithawali and even bolder still in Kakanmat, you find an entire evolution of architectural style. Why would you split a temple into two levels, into a Pataleshwar and one level on top? I don't have the answer to that as yet. We don't have a clear answer to that, but it's another experiment. So even today you find ki aap ghar mein do puja rakhni sakte, allowed nahi hai aapke liye, by if you go by Vastu Shastra. So you have actually got two levels of worship in the same temple. Is that not a violation of Vastu Shastra? Are there some bylaws of Vastu Shastra that we don't know of? It's interesting.
Or was there for worship and the other level was not a worship place, or probably just a room. Maybe there was a underground chamber not meant for worship, or maybe the worship was happening underground aur upar waise chhat bana di gayi aur waise kamra bana diya gaya.
Bilkul ho sakta hai. And isme ek parallel aur hai. Bahut pehle Mewad mein ghumte, gaon mein ghumte waqt, wahan do teen gaon hai. Ek to hai Baroli, dusra hai Bijoliya. Wahan pe bhi maine aisa ek temple dekha tha jisme ek shivling tha underground jagah pe and wahan pani bharta tha. So perhaps it is, the idea is to create an underground Ganga effect, if I may say that.
Right.
Which is easier to do if the shivling itself is below the level of the ground.
Right.
So that's interesting. Then what I haven't covered here, because in interest of time, we've already spent an hour, is if I were to do a second version of this talk, it will completely revolve around fort architecture. So something happens in the 12th century, which is obviously the Delhi Sultanate comes in. There have been invasions in the past. Remember, Harshvardhan also went to the Deccan and he got beaten. He got thrashed by Pulakeshin and came back. So there have been invasions in the past, but perhaps the intensity and the frequency of invasions into the Deccan increased after the Sultanate period. And this area was trampled through repeatedly. So therefore, the construction of new temple architecture seems to stop at the 12th century and doesn't go any further. You have, of course, the odd temple site that is created now. Remember, Orcha is primarily a temple site and it is not far away from here as the crow flies. You drive another 3 hours east, you will end up in Orcha. The Pitambara Peet in Datia, while it is a relatively new structure, is also the site of an ancient temple. So temple construction did not stop entirely, but experiments in temple design almost ceased to happen. Now you have what you have after the 12th century is forts. The Narwar that you see of today is a medieval fort. One of its darwazas is called Alamgir Darwaza, after Aurangzeb. Gwalior Fort is a medieval fort. It's built on the site of a very ancient fort, but then it's also been restored heavily. And Gwalior district has at least 20 more forts. So there was an entire network of forts. Again, as I said, history doesn't come in isolation. It comes in zones. So you have...
Arjun, while you are talking, if you give me permission, I want to share this.
Please.
Yeah, I have been, putting my own map. This is Gwalior. और इसके ऊपर जो हम इलाके घूम के हटे हैं, we have just seen Naresar और Nareshwar, which is not too far from the airport and Air Force Base. There is an ancient rest house. I'm sure you must have seen that.
Yeah.
और जो पावनी ruins की मैं बात कर रहा था, they appear something like this. And that's why I was confusing them with IT. It's quite similar. Radha Krishna temple is also built over old site. IT मैंने अभी tag किया आपकी बात सुनकर. Then Bateshwar, Gadi Padavli, Mitawli, I have. Nurabad ka bridge to is very new. Forts, yeah. Of course. Abhi to apne forts ko to touch hi nahi kiya. Kakan Mutt is there. One fort that you have shown is...
Pahadgarh.
Ratangarh, Singholi, Bhansodgarh. Gagraon aa gaya, this is Rajasthan.
No, you have to go to the north. You have Chanderi mein aa gaye ho.
Pichor.
No. There are actually two Pichors. So there are the one Pichor is in Gwalior. There's a Gwalior Pichor and there's a Shivpuri Pichor. Gwalior Pichor has a fort there.
Right. So one fort. एक ये पहाड़गढ़ आ गया.
और पहाड़गढ़ से आप अगर you go back to Kailaras. And you just go left of Kailaras, just zoom out a little bit. Abhi hum zoom in kar rahe hain. Yeah, that's the Pahadgarh fort.
Right.
So just go a little slow zooming out and move to the northwest. Northwest.
Itaj Rock Art Gallery is one that you have mentioned.
Yeah. So aapne jahan Pahadgarh likha hua hai na, fort se dur. So thoda sa aur dur hai usse. So if you go to the left, ab aap aage Kailaras pe na, so Sabalgarh is a fort there.
Sabalgarh is
extremely difficult to access. I went to Sabalgarh. So okay. the town has built itself at the foot of the fort.
Right.
And it is gradually, the town is becoming so congested that it's becoming difficult to drive up to the fort. The fort is still drivable, but it's becoming quite difficult to drive up.
Right. So that's Sabalgarh and people have put some of the pictures over here. Looks beautiful.
Yeah. But gradually crumbling.
Yeah. और हमने एक और कौन सा डिस्कस किया था, नाम भूल रहा हूँ, the one, the largest fort,
Narwar. So that you have to go drive southwards from Gwalior on the road to Shivpuri.
Narwar I have here.
So ये जो, हाँ ये आपको जो
Narwar मैंने किया हुआ already. कहाँ गया?
नहीं, आप तो रायसेन के पास पहुंचे. यू रीच साउथ ऑफ भोपाल, यू हैव टू गो नॉर्थ अगेन. ब्रो, आई थिंक देयर आर मल्टीपल नर्वर्स. आई थिंक स्पीकिंग अप सम रॉन्ग नर्वर. इट इज स्पीकिंग अप अ नर्वर व्हिच इज नियर भोपाल. यू हैव टू मैन्युअली कम टू शिवपुरी.
और उसकी बावली को ऑलरेडी नर्वर के अंदर मल्टीपल स्टेप वेल्स हैं और वेल्स हैं.
हां, बहुत सारे वेल्स हैं.
दिस इज वन कुंड जिसके अंदर कितनी सारी वेल्स बनी हुई है. एंड आई एम श्योर अगर वहां जाकर देखेंगे तो सबकी डेप्थ अलग अलग मिलेगी. मतलब एक कुंड के अंदर कुएं भी हैं और स्टेपवेल भी है. कुंड में कुआं, कुंड भी है. सो दिस इज क्वाइट एन इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग टू सी.
बहुत सारे.
सो दिस इज
नरवर का जो किला है, इट इज वेरी क्लोज टू द सिंध रिवर. सो द सिंध रिवर, एक्चुअली सम पार्ट ऑफ इट माइट बी फ्लोइंग अंडर द हिल ऑफ नरवर. सो फ्रॉम वेयर इट ड्रॉज द एक्वीफर ड्रॉज द वाटर.
एंड दैट्स द फोर्ट.
It's a huge fort, as you can see on the map. If you see the outline,
it is.
It is perhaps at least the size of Tughlakabad, if not bigger than Tughlakabad.
Right.
If I may give a Delhi example,
multiple cones and all. So yeah. So I think we have explored only a fraction of this area.
Yeah. It's so filled with heritage. That I can have a 5-hour conversation sitting here.
Yes.
Ater ka Killa. Ater is where, again, part of Pansing Tomar was shot. And it is across the Chambal River. It is not right on the Chambal River. Agar Ater pe aap ek cannon ko rakh do na, Chambal becomes impossible to cross. And wahan pe ek, there's a bridge of boats there, pontoon bridge, which is broken. So people tend to cross by a a little boat there, and वहाँ मैंने भी river crossing attempt की थी. वो काफी hilarious थी because मैं तो नाव में चढ़ गया. वो नाव काफी बड़ी थी, मुझे लगा कि 20-30 लोग तो ले ही लेगी, लेकिन वहाँ के लोगों की ingenuity इतनी थी कि उन्होंने एक मोटरसाइकिल को घुसाया उस नाव के अंदर, फिर एक और मोटरसाइकिल घुसाया, फिर एक आदमी आया वो लेके आया अपने भैंसे को. तो हमने प्रोटेस्ट किया कि भैया भैंसे को तो मत घुसाओ नाव के अंदर, द नाव विल कैप्साइज. So what they did was they tied the bhaisa to the nav and the bhaisa was floating along, swimming along with us. And as the water got deeper, the bhaisa began protesting. And we were holding on for dear life, hoping that the bhaisa will not capsize the boat. Because Chambal mein wo bhi hai magarmach. So we've had some interesting trips here. And isme kisse bahut saare hain. Jaise ab jo edge of violence ki hum baat karte hain, wo edge of violence gaya nahi is area mein. एक बार मैं धनतेरस के दिन इस एरिया में घूम रहा था, एंड आई फाउंड सडनली लॉट ऑफ पीपल विद गन्स एंड मोटरसाइकिल्स अराउंड. ये क्या हो रहा है? सो अपेरेंटली देयर, यहाँ हम लोग धनतेरस के दिन बर्तन लेते हैं, वहां वो लोग बंदूक लेते हैं.
इंटरेस्टिंग.
इट इज स्टिल, इट इज अ फॉर्म ऑफ मेटल, राइट? द एंटायर थिंग इज मेड ऑफ मेटल एंड वुड, लार्जली मेटल. सो हाउ टू वर्शिप ऑन धनतेरस? वी बाय यूटेंसिल्स, दे बाय गन्स. इट्स अ कल्चरल चेंज. पहली बार 2005-2006 में मैं गया था, उस टाइम जीपीएस था नहीं और ना कोई प्रेसिडेंट था किसी का, कोई जो गया हो इसके पहले. सो आई हैड टू आस्क फॉर असिस्टेंस टू नो डायरेक्शंस. सो आई वेंट टू अ लोकल पोस्ट ऑफिस, मेट द पोस्ट मास्टर हु हैपन्ड टू बी फ्रॉम मोरेना, एंड ही वाज वेरी हैप्पी टू शेयर द लोकेशंस ऑफ दीज रिमोट प्लेसेस व्हिच नोबडी हैड हर्ड ऑफ टिल देन. आई मेट द पोस्ट मास्टर अगेन सम 7 years लेटर इन 2012. दिस टाइम इट इज ही हु आस्क्ड मी फॉर अ फेवर. सो ही सेड कि आप अखबार में है ना, कैन यू गिव मी सम हेल्प? आपको क्या चाहिए बताइए. He said कि जो मेरे ब्रदर इन लॉ है वो हाईवे पे कहीं ढाबा चलाते हैं और उनसे उनके नेबर से नेबरिंग ढाबे से लड़ाई हो गई थी, एंड लड़ाई में उन्होंने अपने नेबरिंग ढाबे के ओनर का हाथ काट दिया. तो he said छोटा सा हाकिया वाकया था, 302 कॉफिन थी, 307 का था. तो द फैक्ट दैट ही वॉज सेइंग दैट सिर्फ 307 सेक्शन 307 ऑफेंस था, 302 का ऑफेंस नहीं था, told me a great deal about the acceptance of violence in this area. Ki aap inke brother in law ne sirf haath kaata tha. So it was very interesting to see the fact that he didn't attach much importance to an incident where his brother in law had chopped off the hand of somebody else. So it is interesting to see. Haan
aapne kya kiya?
Ma'am, main unko thank you goodbye bolke wahan se cut liya because I realized that I don't want to meet the brother in law at all.
अर्जुन सर, ये आपने इतना हैवी टॉक था मेरे लिए, तो मतलब बाकी सब आई थिंक बहुत नोन और पढ़े हुए थे. मैं तो बहुत इन सब मामलों में बड़ी इग्नोरेंस से भरी हुई हूँ. तो मुझे एक चीज बता दीजिए, योगिनी टेंपल क्या होता है? मुझे वही नहीं समझ
रहा. योगिनी इज एन ऑफशूट ऑफ द हिंदू फेथ. इट्स बेसिकली अ ब्रांच वेयर, सी, देवी वर्शिप हैज बीन एट द कोर ऑफ द हिंदू फेथ फॉर ऑलमोस्ट एवर, फॉरएवर. So when you are worshipping the yoginis, it is actually a form of worshipping Shakti. And there are different interpretations of yoginis. There are 64 yogini temples. There are 81 yogini temples. Why it is following this factor of, see, 8 into 8 is 64. 9 into 9 is 81. Why does it follow this? I am not very sure. I don't know. There is perhaps some astronomical reason behind this, which I have not yet fathomed. The seminal work on this is a book by Vidya Dahejia. But even in her book, she has missed the point about, is there a reason behind this 64 and 81 number being there? Of course, there are various numbers. For example, 108 is a very important number for Hinduism. There are, when you worship prayer beads, it is 108. So there is perhaps another reason for this, a spiritual symbolic reason, which I have not yet grasped. I have not yet evolved to that level. Perhaps it will come to be one day. But the quest of the yogini temples has taken me into very strange places. And all these temples are in isolated spots. I went to a little place called Dudhai. As the crow flies, Dudhai is very close to some of these places. It is in Lalitpur district of UP. Outside Dudhai, in an isolated spot, is a broken yogini temple lost in a forest. So when I asked some villagers, ki aap mujhe rasta dikhayenge wahan ka, unhone mana kar diya ki us jagah hum log nahi jaate. This was in 2008. They were fearing to go to an ancient temple site in 2008. Imagine the extent of fear. Because ek point tha jahan pe association ye tha ki yogini temples were also associated with human sacrifice. So perhaps that is the cause of some of this. There is a question mark over the authenticity of human sacrifice or not. Sometimes the yoginis are called a cult. There is a perhaps an issue with that as well. but we have to go deep into tantric form of Devi worship to know more about the yoginis.
So as you said, and someone else also said, yogini temples were a very important site for dacoits. So maybe wo bhi ek fear factor hoga ki...
Ma'am, wo the recent time pe tha, because dacoits to 19th century mein aaye.
Okay.
And I would like to spend, I'll digress from this, after the yoginis, and spend, shayad dacoit ki hone ka culture yahan pe kyun tha. I'll come back to that as well. So, sticking on the yoginis, where have I found yogini sites? Mithavali temple, is a Chaucer yogini temple. There is, of course, Naresar Chaucer yogini site. Is one of the temples in Bateshwar Chaucer yogini? Perhaps it is. Then I go further east. Dudhai clearly has a Chaucer yogini built in the circular shape. Most of the circular temple shrine has broken. So, we can't do much there. Varanasi has a place called Chausati Ghat. Wahan main andar ghumta hua gaya galiyon mein, to wahan mujhe ek Devi ka mandir mila. It is too much of a coincidence that Chausati Ghat pe hi Devi ka mandir hai. And wahan pe ek kone mein ek bilkul kali idol thi, uske upar itna suit laga hua hai, agarbatti aur kya kya jala ke, kapoor aur agarbatti jala ke, ki uska form dikhai nahi de raha, lekin wo ek ancient idol hai, for sure. Wahan at least 2 aisi idols hain. और वहां गलियों में इतनी रिकंस्ट्रक्शन एक्टिविटी हो चुकी है कि कुछ समझ में नहीं आता कि उसका ओरिजिनल फॉर्म क्या था. खजुराहो में देयर इज डेफिनेटली अ चौसठी टेंपल. जबलपुर के आउटस्कर्ट्स पे भेड़ा घाट में देयर इज अ इंटैक्ट चौसठी योगिनी टेंपल. टू साइट्स आई मेंशनड इन ओरिसा, रानीपुर झरियाल इन बोलंगीर व्हिच आई हैव सीन, एंड हीरापुर विलेज आउटसाइड भुवनेश्वर, बोथ हैव चौसठी योगिनी टेंपल्स. सो देयर आर दीज 8-10 temple/temple sites which exist. और ये होने चाहिए छत्तीसगढ़ में, बिकॉज एक सेंट्रल इंडिया का आप देख रहे हैं, जैसे एक बेल्ट बना जा रहा है, जो बेल्ट यहाँ से शुरू होता है मुरैना से, वो जाता है ओडिशा तक. सो कैन देयर बी अ चौसठ योगिनी टेम्पल समवेयर जस्ट वेस्ट ऑफ दीज प्लेसेस, समवेयर इन राजस्थान? परहैप्स देयर इज. और अगर आप यहाँ से राजस्थान में घुसेंगे, यू क्रॉस द बॉर्डर फ्रॉम श्योपुर, गेट इन टू राजस्थान, दिस इज वन ऑफ द रीजन्स ऑफ राजस्थान विच इज गॉट मोस्ट डेंस वेजिटेशन. Are those dense vegetation forests hiding some Chaucer Yogini or other temples? 100% they will be. And we have to go and find them. We have to do research ourselves. It's a bit like perhaps doing shikar. The thrill of the hunt is in the chase. So I'll say that to the end this. Coming back to
Yogini,
the
Yogini temple are specific to the central region.
Just wanted to know one thing. जो खजुराहो टेंपल्स है वो भी योगिनी टेंपल्स में कंसीडर होते हैं, वो ऑल टुगेदर डिफरेंट है?
मैम वो डिफरेंट है. सो देयर इज एट लीस्ट वन योगिनी टेंपल देयर, वन कंफर्म्ड, द अदर्स आर फॉर वेरियस गॉड्स, प्रिंसिपली शिवा एंड विष्णु.
ओके, गॉट इट, थैंक यू.
या सो यू सी
खजुराहो में योगिनी टेंपल इज डाउन साउथ, यू नो, इन द वेस्टर्न ग्रुप ऑफ टेंपल्स. ये रेक्टेंगुलर स्ट्रक्चर इज चौसठ योगिनी टेंपल, बाकी खजुराहो टेंपल्स ऊपर है.
ओके.
So ये structure जो है ये actually broken है. So unfortunately it is broken. So as you can see, Vikram, the same format. खजुराहो के सारे temples एक गांव में दो groups में हैं, largely दो groups में. चौसठ योगिनी temple बिल्कुल अलग है. So there is again the common pattern is remarkable here. So if ever perhaps one day we can do a talk on the yogini temple separately, which is it's quite remarkable that there should be so many in one geography. Why are
Arjun, now that you have said that, मैं वही notice कर रहा था. Yes, they are actually on a line, because यहाँ से उड़ीसा के अंदर, so probably one of the geographic lines, जैसे इधर से when I'm tracing उड़ीसा के अंदर we have one, छत्तीसगढ़, झारखंड में है, नहीं छत्तीसगढ़ में भी है.
छत्तीसगढ़ में ऐसा कई बार हुआ है कि योगिनी temples गिर गए हैं और उन्हीं के जगह पे मंदिर बने हैं. विचार modern day Devi temples, they don't necessarily acknowledge Chaucer Yogini, but they are Devi temples.
Right.
So, you know, if you were to trace a pattern, and perhaps we can do a little full-scale project on this one day, we find where is the route going through, where are the dots, and we try and join the dots and see if there is anything on the dotted line where we find something else. So, Bheda Ghat is very important as Chaucer Yogini temples go. ये जो श्राइन है भेड़ाघाट का सेंट्रल श्राइन, ये तो शायद थोड़ी बाद की बनावट है, बट एज यू कैन सी बाय द सर्कुलर श्राइन अराउंड इट, इट्स इंटरेस्टिंग.
या इन भेड़ाघाट,
और योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग नितेश, योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग
नितेश, वॉइस नितेश,
shrine yoginis ka.
Sorry, Nitish, I couldn't get you. Your voice is breaking quite badly. Can you put it in the chat window?
Strange, I can't even mute him. Some issue. Nitish, we can't hear you. Can you please put in chat?
Okay, I was saying that there are some...
Can't hear at all.
Ab awaaz aa gayi thi waise aapki.
Yeah, Nitish, so Bhedaghat has very idols intact. In fact, if you go to Ranipur Jharial in Bolangir, almost all the idols are intact. And if you go to Hirapur, you will find at least 90% of the idols are intact.
And meri awaaz abhi aa rahi hai. So I was just saying that these Chausat Yogini temples were known as a place of Tantra Vidya practice.
Yes, they were known as they were situated
out of the town or the village, and they, that's why they are so much isolated from other.
I haven't heard you clearly, yeah, but I think what you're saying is Nitish, sorry, I couldn't hear you, but I think what you're asking is, are all the sites outside the village? In every single case, I found,
and that could be one reason why locals avoid visiting that place, or locals avoid going to
Nitish. Hear you, Nitish.
Nitish can't hear you at all. Can't make out. Okay, Nitish, just type in the chat window. That will be best, I think.
Yeah, I was trying to say that these yogini temples were places of Tantra Vidya practices. That's why they are isolated from other temple, other group of temples, or situated away from the cities or the small villages. And that's why people avoid going to these places.
Yes, Tantra Vidya. And perhaps in the word on some of them is that there was human sacrifice also, which is why they were outside the villages, which is why perhaps there is an aura of fear still attached to them. So, for example, if you go to Ranipur Jharial, which Vikram had just gone to, the Ranipur Jharial Yogini Temple is exactly like Mitauli. It's built on a rocky hillock on a slight height. The difference being that in this place, the entire hillock is dotted. Vikram, what you can't see here, what Google Earth is not telling you, is that the entire hill is dotted with small, small, small temples.
Right.
Exactly the same as you're mentioning that small temples around the Chausat Yogini temple. I have also observed this in Mitauli, because there the other hilltop at the back of that Mitauli temple, I literally walked down the hill of Mitauli and climbed up there, and I have found 2-3 remains of very small temples near Mitauli.
Yeah. So even if you go, I'll give you a few more names of villages. There is a village called Paroli. There is a place called Bhaisora. There is a village called Amledha. There is a village called Ardoni. Ye tino Ardoni, Amledha and Bhaisora, ye Mitauli ke 5 kilometer radius mein aate hain. Each of them has small but magnificent shrines of their own. So all three of them are beautiful, and there are many, many more. So it's a huge geographic region which has dotted with temples. And if you go there, I've shown you today is the summary of like 7 or 8 different trips. And you can spend a lot of time hunting around, even in thickly forested areas, you will come across some things. So,
I would like to just add one thing here.
Sure.
While, yes, they are isolated from villages, they are isolated from what we know as modern village centers and stuff like that. Also, the kind of resources which were required to create some of these temples could not have been done without the patronizing, you know, without the partnership or without the sponsorship of the local rulers or the local moneyed people.
Yeah.
So while they were on the peripheries, they were very much a part of certain faiths. And also, frequented by the Rajas, especially the Kshatriya community, the people who took themselves on as rulers and stuff, which, till very much later. Kali or Jogini or these people were primarily the deities of the ruling class.
Yeah.
So that also needs to be taken into consideration. So while these might have been in the peripheries of geographical areas, in terms of patronization, there was no, absolutely no lacking.
Not at all. In fact, the rulers, in fact, some of, a lot of the, as you said, Kshatriyas, the Rajput rulers, before they would have gone to battle, would have come here.
Yes, yes. There would be a sacrifice of sorts. Yeah. There would be a puja of sorts.
Yeah.
Until very late, you know, I come from Bengal. And in Bengal, there was this huge problem with dacoits in the 18th and 19th century and for part of the 20th century. And the biggest ones of them, Raghu Dakat and so on, all these people, they were tantrics. And they donated huge amounts of money for the creation of certain temples. So while on the periphery geographically, socially, not so much.
Especially for the ruling class.
Absolutely.
And they've got so much. In fact, if you look at it, Mehrangarh in Jodhpur, there is a story of a human sacrifice which has gone into the building of Mehrangarh also, right? That's a medieval fort. So the human sacrifice thing doesn't quite go away. When I went to, for example, east of this place, where I went to Kalinjar, when I went there for the first time in 2007, I was told, "Aap yahan se bhag jao, the fort is a scary place." So Kalinjar has a very violent history. So Kalinjar is a place where there was human sacrifice practiced by some of the temple priests there. Later, it gave way to some of the dacoit groups in that area. And the dacoit groups in modern day independent India became kidnapping groups. So, wo log, and remember where Kalinjar is. Kalinjar is right on the border of UP and MP. So, aap MP se uthao, Bihar se uthao, UP se uthao, aur yahan itne remote spot pe le aao. And every person who was kidnapped for purpose of ransom wasn't returned. Some of them were killed there. So, when I went to Kalinjar for the first time, there were two companies of UP police, provincial armed constabulary, sitting inside the fort to ward people like that off. And they were extremely suspicious ki ye kaun aa raha dekhne ke liye. So they thought, am I some dacoits ke liye rakhi karne aa raha hun, ya koi kidnapping gang ka kuch sadasya hun, etc. So I had to tell them, boss, I'm not that. So thank you.
So there have been
there have been some interesting moments. I went to this region last in 2018, the Kalinjar region, not Morena. I've been more recently to Morena. So I went there in late 2018. And wahan aapko chalte firte itne violent incident dikh jayenge. I went to one district archaeology museum, not even district, it's a place called Charkhari. Chhota sa kasba hai. Wahan ek chhota sa museum bana hua tha. Uske samne gaya to wahan ek bheed ikatthi ho gayi thi. So the bheed was already there before I came. And they thought I was from the police. Why? Because there was a dead body lying inside, in front of the museum.
Oof.
So they thought I was some sort of forensic guy who had come to do something. I said, boss, I'm not a forensic guy. They thought I had a camera and all that, right? So the cops came and they said, "Aap photo lene." I said, "Main photo lene aaya, but not a kind of a body." So somebody had murdered some other poor guy and had left the body there, and then the museum was shut down right at the museum door. So we went to Charkhari town, another gathering of people next to a pond. Why? Somebody has jumped in and committed suicide. So body nikal rahe wahan se. So there is an edge of violence in these areas. So I'm quite careful when I go in. But as long as you can speak their language and don't look like an alien, it's okay. And don't have too many ostentatious displays of wealth, then it's okay. And baki Bhagwan ka haath hai. But as I said, what I showed you today is only like a tip of the iceberg. The Morena, Gwalior, Bhind region is huge. And I can do another presentation where I don't touch a single temple. I only talk about forts. So I talk about the layers within Gwalior Fort. I talk about the 14 or 15 forts around Gwalior, in Gwalior district alone, more forts in Dathia. I talk about the Baulis of Dathia. And they're all medieval. Then I swing southwards to my favorite region, which I will not mention. Otherwise, Vikramjit will say I will take the next 2 hours for that.
It's Chanderi, right?
Aapne boli diya.
Arre, maine boli diya because Chanderi par to mujhe aapke saath session karna hai, guys. The kind of work that Arjun has done on Chanderi. I mean, विल ब्लो योर माइंड ऑफ. ये तो कुछ भी नहीं था, ये ट्रेलर भी नहीं था चंदेरी के सामने. So we'll do one.
I'd be very much interested for the fourth session, because fourth is something that the strategy and how it is built and all those things, I'm very much interested.
Yeah, we will do a fourth session. And as Vikram said, Chanderi also has so much around it. In fact, Vikram, what you will love to know is that I've been doing some more mapping of the route from Gwalior to Chanderi. While I had seen at least a dozen or so sites there, I found at least 16 more. So, some of them I have to be prepared for a disappointment. Some of them you go to and you find absolutely nothing. Some of them you find something so magnificent that you wonder ki yaar wo description mein likha tha wo kya bakwas tha. Just forget about the description. So I'll give you one example. I went to a little village called Srinagar in Mahoba district, UP. ASI ki jo description hai, it's like a line item in the ASI list of, I think, Lucknow Circle or Allahabad Circle. Very interesting description. It says that Mahoba Chandela Sun Temple inside a medieval water body. Sounds magnificent, right? Sun Temple inside a medieval water body. मैंने उस विलेज के चार घंटे चक्कर काट लिए, कुछ नहीं मिला मुझे. फिर मैंने दो तीन बुढ़ाऊ लोगों को पकड़ा कि भैया आप बताइए अंकल जी कुछ यहाँ पे क्या था. Then they pointed me to some place कि हमने बचपन में वहां खेलते थे. Those gentlemen were at least 80 years old. उनका बचपन means उनके -70 years कर लो आप. You go back to around independence. Then I found in one place completely dry, large depression in this in one place. उसके बीच में एक छोटा सा प्लेटफॉर्म है जिसके ऊपर पूरी घास उगी हुई है और झाड़ियां उगी हुई. इसमें दो पिलर खड़े हैं और एक गहरा कुआं है. शायद वो सन टेम्पल था जो पूरी तरह गिर गया है. अब वहां कुछ भी नहीं है. आई डोंट नो व्हेन द एएसआई लिस्ट ऑफ द एरिया व्हेन सम ऑफिशियल लास्ट वेंट एंड सॉ इट. Because there is no sun temple, there are two pillars. The lake has vanished. It has completed. There is no water. It has evaporated. Not a single drop is there. In fact, आपको सिर्फ वो depression दिख जाती है. इसलिए पता चलता है कि यहाँ कुछ low lying area है, शायद water body. ये water body थी. लेकिन कई जगह क्या हुआ है? Especially in the case of the Chandelas were extremely fantastic builders of water tanks and reservoirs. So आपको Chandela river water tanks मिलेंगे Varanasi के outskirts पे. And वहां पे आप उसके बगल में ये लोग बनाएंगे मंदिर. So if you go into Varanasi, you drive south of Banaras to an outlying area. I've forgotten the area's name. The temple is known as Kardhameshwar. It is built alongside a existing pond, and the temple is clearly 11th, 12th century, 13th century maximum, and it's got Chandela period iconography on it. It is sometimes difficult to differentiate between Chandela period iconography and the iconography of their former master dynasty, the Gujar Pratiharas. Sometimes it is difficult. I showed that idol, those icons to Shri K.K. Muhammad and to few others. They were unable to clearly distinguish between whether it is Chandela or whether it is Gujar Pratihara. But because it is built next to a water body, the indications are perhaps it is more Chandela than Gujar Pratihara. Ek aur mazedar baat ye hai ki Chandela water bodies itni sari hai to usko revive kiya gaya. Jab revival hua, तो अखिलेश यादव आ गए इनॉग्रेट करने के लिए. तो somebody had to tell him कि बॉस ये हजार साल पुराना है, आपको इनॉग्रेट करने की जरूरत नहीं है, आपको सिर्फ थोड़ी साफ सफाई करानी है. बट पॉलिटिशियंस बीइंग पॉलिटिशियंस, दे डू व्हाट दे डू. सो
वाओ लवली. आई मीन अर्जुन, दिस वाज अ लवली सेशन, एंड दिस इज जस्ट समथिंग, यू नो, मोर लाइक अ टीजर दैट यू गिव, सो दैट पीपल वुड नो दैट यस, देयर इज समवन कॉल्ड अर्जुन कुमार और इनकी बातें सुननी चाहिए.
सर मैं इस रीजन में, आई जस्ट लीव यू विद वन लास्ट थॉट. इस रीजन में मैं घुसा था फाइनली व्हेन आई गॉट सम राहत फ्रॉम माय अर्ली डेज ऑफ वर्क. आई वेंट इन 2005. अंटिल देन, यू नो, व्हेन यू आर ग्रोइंग अप, यू फील दैट यू विल टेक गो अलोंग विद योर पेरेंट्स और गो अलोंग विद योर कजिन्स और गो अलोंग विद योर फ्रेंड्स. देन आई रियलाइज्ड नोबडी एल्स इज इंटरेस्टेड, सो आई टुक ऑफ ऑन माय ओन. आई सेड आई विल डू ग्वालियर, दतिया, ओरछा एंड आई विल गो खजुराहो इन वन ट्रिप. आई स्टॉप्ड हियर एंड इट टुक मी 6 इयर्स टू रीच खजुराहो बिकॉज देयर इज सो मच इन दैट रीजन एंड इट इज स्टिल नॉट फिनिश्ड.
मैं मेरा अभी तक खजुराहो इसलिए पेंडिंग है बिकॉज़ आई हैव टू डू अ रोड ट्रिप ऑफ एटलीस्ट 7 to 10 डेज बिकॉज़ आई विल स्टॉप ओवर एट उर्चा और झांसी एंड देन स्पेंड एटलीस्ट 5 डेज इन खजुराहो बिकॉज़ मुझे एक से दो दो या तीन दिन प्रोबेबली तो सिर्फ ईस्टर्न ग्रुप ऑफ वेस्टर्न ग्रुप ऑफ टेम्पल्स में चाहिए. मेरा एक दिन से ज्यादा लग जाएगा कडरिया महादेव को ही स्टडी करने में. दैट इज then I go for the first time. बाद में तो दो कई बार जाना पड़ेगा उसे properly study करने के लिए.
So when you go there, if you have time on your hands, go to Ajaygarh. So you know, as I said, forts never come together. They come in large zones. So Kalinjar has a sister fort, Ajaygarh. Ajaygarh lies in Panna district of MP. Kalinjar is in Bandra district of UP. And had it not been for so much pollution today, you would have been able to see one fort from the other. Kalinjar is drivable. You can go all the way to the top and all through it. Ajaygarh is not. Ajaygarh, you have to climb.
But it has a beautiful temple, the Ajaygarh one. My documentation says.
Yeah, it has multiple beautiful temples. It also has a holy tank.
No, Ajaygarh is one of the princely states also. Mere cards, I haven't shared these cards with you. No,
I've got the cards.
Okay. Ajaygarh is a princely state also. Yes. 11 gun salute. 0.2 into 10,000. So it's like less than 2,000 square kilometers. Chota sa area hai.
So if you have a little more time, I can share a few more pictures of Ajaygarh only with you.
Sure.
Just give me a second. Let me kind of open that folder.
We can end the session officially here.
Yes, we can end the session. Then we can carry on. For those who are interested can stay on.
And casual chit chat can happen.
Yeah, yeah. वो तो हमारा चलता रहता हमेशा लगातार. Let me go to my last Ajaygarh trip. I will just share my screen again.
Please do.
Can you see this?
Yeah.
Oh, that is the palace of the current royals of Ajaygarh, as seen on the from the fort.
Beautiful, amazing image.
So you have to actually go. This fort is the hard way up. So that's I'm on the fort here, and that's the little palace there. So I was just trying to do some idiotic creativity out here, but here is where you find the old huge Ganesh idol. Embedded into the steps. And you get further into Ajaygarh. So this is a Chandela inscription mentioning Parmadi Dev. Extensive signs of Shiva worship. You were able to see that as they're moving through, right? Pictures, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Vichira.
The fort or my trip?
The fort.
This is the last built around 10th, 11th century, but it's been added to over the years. So the last construction at the fort was around 11th century.
The Ajaygarh dynasty is not that old. They're about 184 years old.
So the Ajaygarh dynasty as it exists now is much, much more recent. But the Ajaygarh fort is a Chandela fort.
And the dynasty right now is the Bundela Rajput dynasty.
It kept changing hands.
Jain structures probably.
These are Jain structures. That seems to be like a warrior figure with a sword and a shield standing. This, I would put it, if I were to correlate and cross-reference from Kalinjar, is a 9th, 10th century idol.
Mahishasur Mardini?
और भी आएगा सर ये देखो सो लुक एट दैट वॉल
वी गॉट द 24 तीर्थंकर्स और उसके ऊपर महिषासुर मर्दिनी
एंड यहां शैवाइट वर्शिप यहां अगेन शैवाइट वर्शिप
सो यू नो दिस इज समथिंग दैट आई हैव सीन साउथ इंडिया में भी बहुत जगह पे शैविज्म और वैष्णविज्म की जो आपस में कॉन्फ्लिक्ट चलती थी उसके चक्कर में जो टेंपल लेके आगे जैसे इन शैविज्म इन लिंग्यात्स एंड अदर कम्युनिटीज वी हैव वन incarnation of Shiva which kills Narsingh Avatar.
Yeah, I've heard that story as well.
Is tarah ki stories bhi exist karti hai, aapas mein bhi conflict bahut chale hai. Lovely.
Ye dekho, so as you keep going up,
wow,
that now clearly is a later idol. So this could have been a creation of the current ruling dynasty. This definitely looks like the medieval mix of Mughal Rajput design. Look at this. You have a personification of a Nandi with a Linga growing on top of it.
Wow.
And mind you, I'm just on the steps. I've not gone inside. I'm just climbing up. So beyond that, what is not visible here is Kalinjar Fort. So again, Vikram, this is the a more recent title. So this again would be the result of the current dynasty's work.
Which Hanumanji is this? This is not Hanuman.
Oh, this is Bhairav. This is a dog. This is Bhairav, I think.
Right.
If this is a dog, this is Bhairav. So now I come to the what is called a Teerthstan here. So clearly Jain idols around the Teerthstan. So an overgrown pond. So legend has it that if you were to pick up a stone from the banks of these ponds, some various wishes will be fulfilled, etc. Yeah. So there used to be a temple here which was demolished and a dargah built. So you still find some remains all around it.
The Amlak.
And imagine the size of the temple this would have resided on top of. Let's go find a few temples. That looks like that's the linga. Shayad ye panchmukhi linga jisko bolte hai na, uska base hai, iske upar shayad ling ko tod diya gaya hai. Now imagine this is the pond. I began getting closer to the pond, and right next to the level of that water hyacinth, whatever it is, are these carvings. They're going out, but they're extending below. But below you can't see unless you get rid of this. And I didn't want to take a step into this, lest it pull me under. These are the temples you mentioned, Vikram, right?
Oh, wow. This is all Ajaygarh.
Ab Ajaygarh mein isme ek interesting baat hai. I'll go back to the earlier temple. Ye jo part hai na, this part. So there is a place above the sanctum where if you kind of athletic enough, you can just put your hands up and pull yourself up. There is a secret chamber above this. Above the sanctum is a secret chamber. Unfortunately, वहाँ गांव के बच्चे नशा करते हैं. But I imagine it would have had some very spiritual use.
So जो मंदिर का जो शिखर बनाया जाता है, उसके अंदर एक कमरा तो बनाया जाता है बड़े मंदिरों में. Normally कमरे के अंदर अनाज भरा जाता है. So it is one of the signs की prosperity के लिए. That's one of the practices that we get from Vastu Shastra, जो नगर architect.
So imagine the Kakanmat temple would have been in this state at one point in time before it was pieced together.
Lovely. Nitesh, so, bus gaadi leke chalte hain yahan par, bus clubhouse pe chalate rehna. Let's pick our car. Arjun ko to mujhe pakadna bahut mushkil ho jata hai saath mein. Arjun ke saath I have done one trip abhi tak. One or two?
Two.
हाँ दो किए. यस, एक हम गए थे उधर जो झूलता मिनारा वो
डावर नजीबाबाद.
यस यस यस,
वहाँ भी हमें इंटरेस्टिंग चीज मिली थी. जा रिमेम्बर इन प्लेस कॉल्ड नगीना वी केप्ट हंटिंग फॉर ओल्ड पठान फोर्ट.
यस,
मिला ही नहीं हमको.
फोर्ट मिल गया था हमें.
वो भी हाँ, वो मतलब पुलिस थाना था.
और उससे पहले हमें वो एक कसाईयों के वो मिल गए थे टूम्स.
विचित्र है, उसमें स्पेलिंग बदल जाती है कभी कभी. सो स्पेलिंग में एक अल्फाबेट बदल जाए तो आप लोग चक्कर खा जाते हो कि कहां जाना है. सो जगह का नाम था मुझेरा, उन्होंने लिखा है मझेरा. So, ढूंढने में टाइम लगा, वहां पहुंच गए. There are four beautiful tombs there of a family called the Sayyids. Now, remember the Sayyid brothers, the notorious Sayyid brothers, came from a place called Badha, also in Muzaffarnagar. So, are these the same Sayyid brothers whose families tombs there are here, or are they separate? I'm not sure. But there are four tombs, all of them of interesting design and fairly large. Vikram, the tombs we found of the Kasais were very small tombs, right? These are large tombs. They were existing in gardens of themselves. The gardens have now been encroached upon and they have become agricultural fields. Mujhera, Majhera, call it what you will. And वहाँ पे ASI की लिस्ट में लिखा है octagonal wall. अब आप देखो octagonal wall में क्या मतलब क्या बदमाशी की है. Wall नहीं, वो well है. It is a well. It is a, that too not. I don't know why they have called it octagonal well. It is a step well. It is a beautiful step well with this, which is still intact. And एक वर्ड एक अल्फाबेट का डिफरेंस वेल हैज बिकम वॉल. तो मैं सोच रहा था कि यार मैं मझेरा स्ट्रोक मझेरा में वॉल कहां से ढूंढूंगा. लोकल्स को कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता उनको. दे कुडंट केयर लेस.
ओके, आई हैव ओपन दैट ऑन माय गूगल और मेरे को वहां पर ऑलरेडी मैंने टैग किया हुआ है. एक ओल्ड शिव टेंपल है और नुसरत यार खान का मकबरा है और काला कोठा है. काला कोठा इज सम सॉर्ट ऑफ पैलेटियल स्ट्रक्चर.
तो इस काले कोठे में मैं गया उसी दिन. काले कोठा आई थिंक इज ऑक्यूपाइड. सो देयर इज अ फैमिली लिविंग देयर.
यस, और
दे हैव एनक्रोच्ड अपॉन द स्पेस एंड लिविंग देयर. उनके घर में उस दिन शादी थी.
अच्छा.
सो आई लैंडेड अप ऑन द डे. सो एंड दे थॉट आई वाज अगेन. सो आई हैव लैंडेड इन वेरी स्ट्रेंज प्लेसेस इन वेरी स्ट्रेंज गाइसेस. सो इन सम प्लेसेस दे थॉट आई वाज सम फोरेंसिक्स गाय. इन सम प्लेसेस दे थॉट आई वाज सम बाराती. आई सेड नॉट अ बाराती, आई जस्ट कम टू सी द प्लेस. आई डिडंट नो दैट इट वाज समबडीज हाउस. So they were very welcoming. Then they welcomed it and they welcomed me and said, "Ki aap dekh lo," and all that. So, and they put one boy with me to show me the place. So I took a few polite photographs from the outside and went off. I mean, unka ghar tha, I didn't want to go inside.
Haveli,
haan. Dilapidated. Okay, great.
मंगरबानी के बहुत मेंशंस आए हैं पिछले 5 सालों में अखबारों में इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ सेविंग द अरावली. इट्स अ वेरी करेक्ट मेंशन.
सॉरी, इज इट
इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ सेविंग द अरावलीज. So I was just wondering, is it true? Is it not true? Because कई बार क्या होता है, rock art is sometimes people in the current era draw squiggles resembling rock art very very finely. ऐसा एक दो एक जगह मध्य प्रदेश में हो चुका है.
JNU के अंदर हमें जो rock art मिला था, so वही अरावली की range तो वही चल रही है. तो JNU का rock art मिला था, वो फिर खो गया. उसमें इतने पौधे हो गए, अब किसी को याद भी नहीं है वो कहाँ मिला था. दोबारा ढूंढना पड़ेगा जाकर. That was not just painting, that was petroglyph,
yeah.
In a petroglyph form. So, wo jo petroglyphs mile the, wahan se unhone they deduced ki ye kafi purana and all. Aur I am super sure ki usi lineage mein, usi line mein aage chalke mein aur cheeze us, kyunki log reh rahe the is belt mein.
Yeah. So, actually bahut sari rock art sites hain jo undiscovered hain. Agar Hampi se aap nadi paar karo, Tungabhadra ko cross karo, ek jagah ek gaon aata hai Anegundi karke. आनेगुंडी में एक बिल्कुल बाहर एक देयर इज अ काइंड ऑफ हिल जिसके एक्सेस बहुत मुश्किल है क्योंकि वहां मधुमक्खियां भी हैं. एंड आई हैड टू जंप अक्रॉस सम रॉक्स. सो दैट्स लाइक 2 रॉक्स एंड बीच में 3 फुट का गैप था. सो आई हैड टू जंप अक्रॉस इट. सो यू हैव टू स्लाइटली फिट आल्सो टू गेट अक्रॉस. आई मैनेज टू गेट अक्रॉस देन. एंड वहां पे रॉक आर्ट बनी हुई है. सो इमेजिन हाउ डीप द हिस्ट्री एंड द प्री हिस्ट्री ऑफ हम्पी गोज. एंड यू कम क्लोजर. आई हैव फाउंड 2 अनप्रोटेक्टेड अनलिस्टेड रॉक आर्ट साइट्स आउटसाइड चंदेरी.
चंदेरी में तो अलग से सेशन करेंगे आपके साथ सर, नो डाउट अबाउट इट.
चलो जी, सो ऑन दैट नोट वी विल पॉज इट.
हाय, नो, जस्ट वन क्वेश्चन अर्जुन और
यस अभिषेक जी.
सो आई एम फ्रॉम भुवनेश्वर प्राइमरली. सो आई डोंट नो लाइक इफ एनीबॉडी हैज स्टार्टेड डॉक्यूमेंटिंग द टेंपल्स बिकॉज़ द टेंपल्स ऑल ओवर आई मीन वेरेवर आई एम स्टेइंग. आई मीन आई स्टे माय हाउस इज इन ओल्ड भुवनेश्वर. आई मीन क्लोज टू लिंगराज टेंपल. बट देयर आर मेनी मेनी टेंपल्स. डू यू नो एनीबॉडी हु इज डॉक्यूमेंटिंग देम?
I have visited that place, walked around that place, and I have actually documented most of them. I had a local friend with me who has been living in that area for like since birth actually, though he's from Cuttack, but he stays in Bhubaneswar. So he took me around all the by lanes, ek ek gali, aur usne do teen aur logon ko bulaya jo wahan par sab ex. So there are many people who are actually mapping it, and they helped me create a map of that area.
So I'm also working on something similar. So I keep doing a lot of research, and I've gathered a lot of material on it, and I'm compiling it into an Excel. I've also visited Bhubaneswar twice, and I've done at least some degree of primary study as well. But in a place like Bhubaneswar, you need to spend many months to get it right. So I've got a list of about maybe 70-80 temples in Bhubaneswar and other parts of Orissa, but the list will probably touch 250 odd by the time this winds up.
Correct, because you said you have been to Bolangir, right?
I've been to Bolangir. Yeah, it's difficult to reach. So when I went to Bhubaneswar, I had Ranipur Jharial on the list. And this was the first trip was in 2011. And I was told at that time that there are a lot of Maoist activity there, so don't go there. Also, there is a river which is in Spate, difficult to cross the river. But it remained very high on my radar. So I went back there in December 2019 from Sirpur in Chhattisgarh. So when you're doing these studies, it's important to forget about state barriers and just look at the easiest navigable route, wherever it may be. And I found it is very easily doable. Well, not that easily. It's still easier to do it from Sirpur in Chhattisgarh than it would have been from Bhubaneswar and Orissa. There is also a desperate need in India to build more airports. And Orissa is magnificent. So if I were to make a list of the most magnificent states by heritage of India, my state, Rajasthan, would not win that contest. Madhya Pradesh and Karnataka would be joint winners. Fighting for the number two slot would be Tamil Nadu and Orissa. So there's so much to be done.
And Arjun, I need to take you to a trip, on a trip to the forts of Punjab. Forts and caravanserais of Punjab. If you've not done it so far.
I've done it. In fact, I've done that trip.
Because I've
actually got a deck which says, which begins at Makbara Peak. I begin there where you have this so-called Makarba Chowk, incorrectly spelt. And then you drive northwards from Sonipat, Panipat, Gharonda. I take a few detours. I go to, say, Asand. Then I go north. I go to Thanesar. I take another detour. I go to Yamunanagar. Then I come back on the main road. I go to Shambhu Sarai, Rajpura, Bahadurgarh. I wind my way through Sikh heritage of Malerkotla. Malerkotla has just been mentioned, through Sirhind, through Sanghol, through Sarai Lashkari Khan, Duraha, uske baad kya, Noor Mahal, Nakodar, Dakhani Sarai.
Bilkul. So, aapne jo aap route le rahe ho, that is perfect. There are many along these, there are forts of Ranjit Singh which are now under either police or army. And
Filor Fort, jo police ke paas hai.
Patiala ke paas Gobindgarh ka kila hai. एक अमृतसर में पटियाला में भी गोल सर्कुलर गोविंदगढ़ किला है विच इज अंडर पुलिस एंड ओनली ऑन संडेज दे लेट पीपल गो इनसाइड फिलौर के अंदर
संडेज बहादुरगढ़ में फॉर एग्जांपल बहादुरगढ़ की आप बात कर रहे हो क्या बहादुरगढ़
है उसे गोविंदगढ़ भी बहादुरगढ़ भी कहते हैं जो
सो बहादुरगढ़ में घुस गया हूं मैं बहादुरगढ़ में इज द ट्रेनिंग सेंटर फॉर पंजाब पुलिस कमांडोस
एग्जैक्टली
सो मैं घुस गया था उसके अंदर सो आई हैड इट्स वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग आई गॉट अ शॉट ऑफ अ मेडिवल गेटवे एंड सामने लिखा है स्मॉल वेपन्स फायरिंग रेंज
Beautiful.
So I went to Sarai Amanat Khan is where I finished. Uske baad to border aa jata hai. And then if you were to trace, I haven't not been to Pakistan. But if I were to trace, I will go to, for example, to a place called Bakshali. So I will look at, for example, the old names. I'll look at, say, Udayana, now called Swat. I'll look at a place called now called Chandrasat. Chandrasat is a
manuscripts तो वैसे भी बहुत famous है history में मैंने भी कई study किए भक्षाली से manuscripts मिले और inscriptions मिले हमें
yeah so very important then you go further you realize that you're on the same trajectory as Kandahar and then you land up at the place where the Americans have run away from Bagram Air Force Base जहाँ के archaeological excavation revealed an idol of the Ganga
perfect sir ये हम लोगों की तो discussion चलती रहेगी हम तो शाम तक बैठे रहेंगे
हाँ और क्या
Perhaps we should, or at least I can end the recording now. Where is it? Yeah.